He put all his soul into a tenor saxophone. He had a way of talking, was a language all his own. Life story, love and glory. Won't you listen as he plays it for you now?
Here comes Leslie Young walking real slow.
He was always dressed immaculately.
Slooping shoulders and that hat.
A pork pie hat.
Impressed with his saxophone up in the air.
He was so soulful, my words. So soulful.
Lester Young was just, you know, he was a god. And he was a god.
Prez lives!
When he played in group settings with Charlie Parker and others, he stood tall and told his story.
As I continued to listen to Bach, Beethoven, Louis Armstrong, and Roy Eldridge, if the music is great, it's timeless.
So what Lester Young is doing, he's sounding relaxed. He would say cool. And he is the coiner of the term in its common meaning.
Lester Young started the be cool, cool pattern, the cool thing.
Prez was always cool.
Lester says, I have nice eyes for the way you play there. He says, if you're interested, the slave is yours.
He was super unique. He called everybody lady.
Lady Bass, you take the next helping, and then we'll follow the swallow back home.
Billy gave you the name of Prez.
When I first came to New York in 34, she was teaching me about the city, you know, which way to go, you know. She's still my lady, dear.
The greatest thing about musical expression is when you have this coming together of the deepest feelings with the absolute control and technique of one's playing.
Prez was like a hipster making his way through this terrible jungle of craziness.
For a black man in the South to be in the company in a love relationship with a white woman was a grievous violation of the law.
Paying dues was part of his life, you know. I mean, the crucifixion, if you can think of things in that way.
Maybe it wouldn't happen to you, you dig? You'll take advantage of me. But all I can do is tell you what happened.
Prez, to me, Prez was music. And that's what I miss.
It's got to be sweetness, man. Sweetness can be funky, filthy, anything. Which part do you want?
School of Social Research and the Drama Workshop owned a theater that was on 47th or 48th Street and 8th Avenue. And one of the places we went to just anoint a joyous closing to the day was to flock down to the Royal Roost. And then our classmates were made up of young men and women that shaped the future of American theater. We had Marlon Brando and Walter Matthau and Rod Steiger and B. Arthur. For a 25-cent bottle of beer, we could sit and listen endlessly to the greatness of the jazz musicians. And I'll never forget, one day on a slow night, Lester used to sit in a booth with his horn by his side, and sometimes we would be at a table not too far away or up against the wall, and he'd invite us over and pat to the seat, and we'd come sit. And the following conversation ensued. Lester, what do y'all do? Students, we study. Oh, yeah? Where you go to school? We go to the New School of Social Research down here, theater. Oh, yeah? And you study what? You study theater. You study theater. Uh-huh. What do you study in theater? Well, there are many divisions. There's directing and playwriting. Uh-huh. And what do you study specifically? Study acting. You study acting? Uh-huh. Tell me, how you do that? And it was the first time anybody had ever asked me, how do you do that? One of the things I felt that would help me give greater clarity to what it was that we did was to say to the musicians, why don't you come see us? And at first it was like a fleeting act of casual offering, but they took us up on it. One night, I was sitting there bemoaning the fact that I had just been notified by the administrators that my subsidy had run out, because I was a GI, had the Bill of Rights supporting us to go get our education. I'd have to find another way, if I wanted to continue my studies, to find the tuition. Lester said, well, why don't you sing? And I said, sing? I said, I'm not a singer. I said, you know. I said, well, what? Yes, you are. We just saw the play, man. We don't do that. So I said, yeah, but I'm not, that was another challenge. That wasn't about this. I mean, this is the home of Ella Fitzgerald and Billie Holiday and Nat King Cole and Billy Eckstein. And
this was Lester Young saying that you could sing.
Encouraging me to get a job as a singer because he saw the play. And I just kind of thought the idea. Didn't realize, well, I don't know any song. We can fix that.
I met Lester one time. I was in the Army. I took 10 days off and went to Canada, Toronto, the Town Tavern. Lester Young was playing there. I put on my civilian clothes. I had the pinstripe suit and the paisley tie and all that stuff. Place was packed. And here comes Lester Young walking real slow. He had the long coat with the raglan sleeves, you know, sloping shoulders, and that hat, that's the pork pie hat. Lester Young had the horn on his side, and he's up on the stand. It had the bandstand would go around slowly. And he was doing a theme song or whatever. He was doing a do 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 do. No, that's not that one. He was going to.
Lester Leach.
I'm going to tell you in English what do 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 mean. All the guys said, you know what do 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 do. We know what that meant. Dirty. So I'm standing at the bar, and I said, man, it's going to take me a long time to get a little something to drink. And behind me, his fingers on my shoulder, like, I turn around, it's Lester Young. Then he said to me from behind, he said, you look like you're from New York. With that, you know, you New York. I said, yeah. He said, what you drinking? I said, cognac. He said, you won't get it here. And I thought he was talking about, there's too many people to get a drink. But he's talking about, he said, let's go down in the wine cellar and get some real cognac. And so I said, he's got the keys to So I followed him down in the wine cellar, the club, and he got in the barrels or whatever they were, and he had two big water glasses and filled mine up and filled his up. His was bigger. And we started talking. I was sipping. He was talking and doing his intermission. I forgot what we were talking about because I was getting tipsy. And I said, I'm talking with Lester Young. I'm in the Army. I just told him I was in the Army. I was on the furlough. And he was talking. And he said, it's time to go back now. And he went up the stairs. Everything slow. But he was slow but moving. He had that kind of forward motion.
This was a guy that used to live on my block. He knew that we were all big Coleman Hawkins fans, so he said, Sonny, who's the greatest tenor man? So I said, Coleman Hawkins. He said, no, Lester Young. So I said, gee, Lester Young, what is he talking about? Let me go and listen to Lester Young. The first records I got by Lester Young was a classic keynote recording with Slam Stewart and Sid Catlett, Johnny Guarneri on piano, and Afternoon of a Bassiate. Sometimes I'm Happy. I Never Knew. And boy, it was just fantastic. Just fantastic. Then after that, of course, I got everything I could get by Lester, you know, and began trying to assimilate what he was doing, his style and everything, in my own playing. Well, the fact that he inspired so many other people, that guys, great players, were able to use what he did and expand on it and have great styles. And I mean, Lester Young was just, you know, he was a god. He was a god. I was with Max Roach's band at the time. We were playing at this place in Detroit, and Lester was there, and he came up and played with the band, you know. So that was great, you know. It was really a highlight of my life. I am supremely fortunate, as I said, that I knew him in the flesh for a minute. Some people think that, oh, his earlier stuff and wow, he was really great. No. He was always great. But his later stuff to me, I mean, it was so soulful, telling a story. And it was a story of life. But boy, that later stuff, man. I mean, Three Little Words, after I heard that, man, I used to play Three Little Words every fucking night. I'd be playing Three Little Words, you know, and I'd be hearing stuff that came from Lester Young that I could expand on in my little expression. And that happened after. This is after that early period. So after the Count Basie early period. So to me, his thing was all the way, going that way up. It wasn't up and then, it was up all the way. The trajectory was straight up.
And being a musician back then, for a black guy, I mean, there wasn't a whole lot that black people could do. It just wasn't a lot. You could be your own gangster as long as you knew the rules and told the line. You could be a preacher, or you could be a carpenter, or you could be a waiter, or you could be a porter. I mean, you compare those things to, you know, being a musician to most people at that time. Everybody wanted to be a musician.
I have a funny story to tell when we were on one of those buses. I don't know if it was in Italy or someplace. I think it was with the Jazz at the Philharmonic, but I can't be sure. And Sonny Stitt was on the bus. God bless him. And Sonny was revved up, and everybody on the bus was sleeping because it's an exhausting way of life. And Stan always insisted in those early days that I go with him, and so I did, but it was tough. And so I like to sit next to Lester, who made very little noise about himself, and it was wonderful. He had a few words, but they were always treasured words. And Sonny went up and down the aisle of that bus, and he was playing and playing and playing, note after note after note. And every now and then he would, Lester was sitting by the aisle, I was sitting by the window, and I could see he was pushing Lester with his elbow as he went by, and he said, "Did you hear that? Did you hear this? Did you hear this?" And finally, Lester said with a really quiet voice, so non-aggressive as opposed to Sonny's, who that was really actually aggressive. And he says, "Yes, ladies, but can you sing me a song?" And everybody on the bus that heard that just fell apart, because he couldn't have said anything that was more right bullseye than what everybody felt. So he was a special kind of man with a special kind of intuition, special kind of intellect, and a huge heart.
So again, I've described him more musically than historically. He was born in Woodville, Mississippi, raised in New Orleans, a professional musician with his father's band as a child and adolescent, emerging in his late 20s with the original Count Basie Orchestra in their glory successes as pop stars. This is 75 years ago, mind you. And then on to a career as an individual player that led to hit records, they're all from the 1940s, and major concert tours that are from the 40s and 50s.
1, 2, 3, 4.
He died over 54 years ago, 2003 years to the day after Julius Caesar's. Beware those Ides of March. In 1959, they took the president from us. Lester Young died at the age of 49, but he is forever. But he is really one of the divine performers of improvised art who has ever lived. He creates a total identity for his instrument that is separate than its previously known concepts and have impact on all subsequent development. But whether you favor one period of Lester Young or over another, or even hear it as anything more than one period, Lester Young, the records he made with Billie Holiday in the 30s and the swing era classics he makes with Count Basie are as magical as any episodes of jazz expression as that can be itemized.